Hi, welcome to my third part of the Chef installation process on Kubernetes. And today we'll see that how to install the object storage on top of the Chef. And we already know that the Chef can deliver the object storage, block storage, file storage in a single unified systems. So we already seen that Chef provide the block storage. It's a name of Redos block device, or simply called RBD. They provide the block storage. And the file storage provided by Chef FS or Chef file systems. So these both are process compliance. And the third one provided by object storage. So this is another thing, but this is not a POSIX model. This is a completely different one. Today we'll going to see that what are the difference and how to enable in the Chef, more specifically Rook Chef we are following. So first we see the architecture of the Chef. So it's like this. The base layer is Redos. Redos is a reliable, autonomous, distributed object stored. So here the word, our all data will be stored and is automatically replicated. And they have self-healing, self-managing, all other features are there. In top of that Redos, there is a multiple layers are there. First layer is libredos. It's a dynamic library. The library can are able to read the data directly without the block storage or ChefFS or file system model. So our app can talk to directly libredos. We can able to access the data. Then apart from that, the three services are provided top of the one. First RBD, it's called block device. So it's mostly used for the in VM purpose. Suppose you want to store the VM hard drive, disk drive here. So they usually use the RBD. So ask the chef, asking the 8 GB drive. The chef is giving the 8 GB, or mostly they go for thin provisioning. But after that, they can format any file system they want, and they attach to VM or a container, and we can utilize it. This is what RBD. So it's a block level access they give in. Next is Chef FS. It's a file system. This is not a no formation. Already file system already there. So here the POSIX compliant distributed file systems are there. So now using our client, you can mount this drive into the system, or we can store file level access. That's mean we can store the particular file, creation directory, everything, all operation we can do in through Chef FS. So in the Kubernetes world, both we can use for the mount this drive, create the persistent volume through this RBD as well as Chef FS, and mount into the pod. That already we seen, we created two storage class and we know that how to mount it. So RBD is exclusive, so we can mount into only one pod. But ChefFS is possible to mount that same volume in multiple pods. That's the difference between the RBD and the ChefFS. Third one is called Redos GW or Redos Gateway. This is what the object storage option is provided. This is a bucket-based REST gateway. So it's a REST API. So it's mean that it's running top of HTTP. So, and it's compatible with S3 and Shift. S3 is a protocol provided by or introduced by Amazon. So same protocol, they can use, you can use that S3, you can access the data. Another one is Shift. Shift is come from OpenStack community. They have own storage APIs. So now Chef is provided both. So it's up to us which one going to use, but we mostly using S3 only. And the differences we need to look into that. So before differences, it's like this. Chef file system, directly you can able to access the files and directories. In the block device, you can get the entire virtual disk. After that, you have the operating system for that read the data or create the file system, everything up to decided by an external entity. But here in the Chef object gateway, we are storing the objects. We'll look into that, what are the differences and everything. And this is a similar structure, what we're talking about. Here, multiple OSDs are running. In our case, 3 OSD is running. And we have 3 monitor pods are running and 2 MDS pods are running like that. Then libredos is a library. They're taking care of the below the thing. So they provided 3 options. One for the block device. We can use the block device to connect the our system. So they provide the kernel module also. So Linux kernel directly can talk to the our libredos and get the data, whatever they want. Another option is go with the ChefFS, what we already seen. So ChefFS is provided, it's like a file sharing model. So our application can talk to the ChefFS directly, or we can do install the NFS server, NFS server talk to the ChefFS. That also possible, that kind of features also available. In the object storage, we have only two API, S3 or Shift API. So our application should use either one of the API, talk to the Redis gateway. We need to look at the, what is the Redis gateway and everything. So mostly this is a one blog. I read about it. It's extremely good about the talking about what is the POSIX and what is the object storage. So in the POSIX file system, they have a lot of almost 60 system calls are there about creation, deletion of files and directory, everything. But when you go for object storage, they have only 4 or 5, put, get, delete, head. It's a follow the HTTP model or REST API model. So only the 4 to 5 API, that's all. So this is not a, if you are using the applications or legacy applications, object storage is, we can't use directly because this is a, first of all, what are the first difference is that when you go for the RBD or HFFS, it's in the Kubernetes point of view, it's a mountable. You can mount that into your volume, either slash MNT or slash data location. After that, your legacy application directly write the data or read the data from slash data local path. But in the object storage, there is no mounting option at all. There is no mounting. Object storage, there is a one server is up and running, one location or one URL. Our application need to call, like how you call Google, we need to call that API. Then we need to tell what need to do, read the data, get the data. And that API can, anybody can call. So it's protected by access key and secret key. So when you call that URL, you need to provide your access key and secret key. So that server that we called as a Redis gateway, do authentication and authorization. Then if all are satisfied, they'll give you whatever data we asked. So that's the big difference between the object storage and normal POSIX file systems, which we are using. But here also there is a kind of a in-between project called POSIX Object Translation. This project is what we'll do. There is some bunch of third-party open source software out there that allow to mount the object storage. But internally what they do, they're converting the POSIX system call to object storage system calls. So the conversion is a performance bottleneck, but despite that, your legacy application may work with this object storage. But again, not all application will work, but majority will work because there is some kind of a limitation as well as restrictions. We'll go into talk about that in the future videos. Now we'll come into the how to install the object storage on our Rook Chef cluster. So go to the Rook website, go to the storage configuration. We have RBD as well as HFFS. Now third is object storage. It's usually called RGW. So is RGW nothing but the Redis gateway. So click the object storage overview. Okay, this is object storage overview. We are going to look into the details like this, but I am already created one GitHub page. It's called Ramki CSC Rook Chef Setup. Here I have Vagrant, the Vagrant script, which I used from the open, me and open source. His script only I have. And we have cert manager, the second video, whatever script I used, it available in this location. Now in this video, whatever we are going to use, that scripts are available, or that YAML file available here, and I have steps also written. So we'll talk about first what Rook Chef provided and what are the modification I did. We'll see that angle. So first is we need to create the configuring the object store. We need to install the object store. Before that, we already did the installing the RBD as well as a ChefFS. I'll show you that one. In the last time we installed the under the CSI RBD, we installed the storage class. In the storage class, we created the chef block pool. This is nothing but a RBD storage location. Here the data are going to stored, and we are giving a replicated. So whatever the data you write, 3 times replicated for the durability purpose. In the ChefFS purpose, we installed the file system dot YAML. So we quickly see the file system YAML. File system YAML, there is a kind called chef file system. This is a second level category. That's mean what chef provided second level is chef file system or ChefFS. So we created the chef file system. Then we created another storage class for this chef file system, and we can use the PVC to use this ChefFS. But now we are going to use object store. So object store, there is a API is available, so kind available called chef object store. Okay, it's available in the name is object in the example directory. So go here, you can see that there are some multiple objects, or the object EC objects are available. When you go for object, they create the chef object store, and it's available as a replicated model also available. There is another option is object EC. It's available in eraser code format. In eraser code format, we'll see what the difference between eraser code as well as a replication model. Suppose you want to store 100 GB data in your storage. In the normal mode, in the replication mode, replication is a factor 3. So 300 GB is used in the storage. But our actual data is 100 GB, but 100 GB data is replicated 3 times, so 300 GB is used. In the eraser code format, we are giving the data chunk is 2 and 1 code chunks. So every data chunk, so every 2 data chunk, 1 code chunk is created. So in this case, if you calculate using this one, 100 GB data is a data chunk. So in half is 50 GB. So total 150 GB is used by entire that 100 GB data. So 100 GB is original data, 50 GB is a parity bits data which is stored. So if any data is missing, using the parity bit, they are able to reconstruct the original data. So the here is storage efficiently utilized, but it takes some CPU computation is more involved here. That algorithm we called Reed-Solomon algorithm, you can go and refer it. They have a lot of features, and we can twist also. I mean, we can kind of customize it. This how many data chunks one coding chunk need to created, that again we can able to modify it. So we'll go this video object EC, but you can use go for object also, that's not an issue. So both are that only the difference. Anyway, metadata pool is should be in the replicated only. Here only metadata information only stored in this pool. Original data will be stored on data pool. So the two pool need to be created or need to be configured, and they have compression modes are available. We'll see that are in the features videos. Now what we'll do, so the important thing is gateway. Up to now, whatever we created that chef block pool or chef file system, there is no server is running. In the ChefFS, the metadata server is running, MDS running, but not for the external user calling the server. But here, you need to run on HTTP server because we are REST API. The REST API should be provided by one HTTP server. So any request come, they do authentication, authorization, and after that, they either store the data or get the data is provided by this gateway. So the gateway running on a particular URL, that URL we needed. That URL only, we need to, from our application point of view, we need to connect this URL. So we'll talk about that part. And they can run the port 80, is in HTTP mode. That means no security is involved. There is another option is, you can run on secure port also. Secure port is 443. So it's running on HTTPS. If you want to run HTTPS, you need to provide a certificate. So anyways, watch second video. I created the cert manager. So from the cert manager, I can easily get one certificate and give the secret name where my security certificates are stored. I need to give the secret name where my security certificates are there. I need to give here. Then the placement and everything need to be modifiable. But anyway, we don't need to do anything. That's all. We need to run this code. So before running, watch my... we go with this one, whatever the same file only I provided here. So the first step is what we'll do, first create the certificate, because in the Rook we need to give the SSL certificate reference we need to give. So first step is create a certificate. So in our code, chef S3 certificate, this is the YAML file we're going to run. Here what we are doing, I'm going to using the same set manager certificate YAML file. Kindly watch my second video on the chef series. I'll create how to configure the cert manager. So based on the same root CA, we creating one certificate for these URLs. So these are the DNS names. The certificates are valid, and the certificate is created in the root chef namespace under the this secret. So object chef object store TLS. This is a secret name. It will be generated after executing this one. That secret have all the CA certificate, public key, private key, all information are there. So first step is execute the certificate. Now ls, go to the my object storage things. Okay, now I'm going to execute kubectl apply s3 chef S3 certificate. That certificate I'm going to generate. Now look like a certificate generated. Kubectl get certificate in the Rook Chef namespace. So you can see that there is a this is certificate name and this is a ready state, and this are all the certificate information stored on the this secret. So you can go and check that secrets are available. So now what to do? Second step is we are going to create the chef object store. So I already created in the my this is one object EC. So we are going to go for eraser coded model. So this is the same one what we see now. It's a chef object store, and it's how the metadata pool is replicated 3 times. But data pool is we are going eraser coded. So 2 data chunks and 1 coding chunks are they were created. And in gateway, I mentioned that secret name which we created in the first step. So first step we create the secret. That secret is I mentioned here, and I enable the port 80 and 443. So whenever the HTTP server, that's mean the gateway is running, it's running on port 80 also, 443 also. 443, they're using this certificate. They're running the HTTPS mode. So all are same. Now we'll apply it. And this chef object store is created in the Rook chef namespace. So second step is kubectl apply minus f object ec.yaml. So it's created. So we can use the k9s. We can see that the gateway is created or not. So go to the Rook chef. Okay, the very important thing is now there is a one gateway pod start to running. You can see that file name is ref Rook chef rgw and object store -a and some numbers. So here -a is a single instances, and this is object stories what we are given in the YAML file. It's a name. So this is a HTTP server, or we can call as a object storage server. This is a server is provided by, sorry, this is server is provisioned by our YAML file. Now we need to connect this part for all your get, post, put operations. So we go for service as well. So go to service. So there is a new service is created. Rook chef RGW, that's a Redis gateway object store. This is our object store, and it's running on one cluster IP, and we can see that they're running on 80 as well as 443. So this gateway provided the both 80 as well as 443. So on normal unencrypted HTTP connection as well as the encrypted HTTPS connection, both are provided. So now object storage installation is done. Now we'll show that now we'll go for the ingress controller, be able to access this gateway from outside. So we'll go on to that part. So here second step is completed. Now we'll go for install the virtual service outside. So we'll show that virtual service. And again, I already did in the second screencast about how to install the Istio. So it's based on that only. Okay, now we'll see that the virtual gateway chef object storage virtual service. This virtual service is a Istio based virtual service, and here I mentioned that if I'm asking s3.ramkit.com, if it's anybody asked, and it's binded with the Ramki gateway which I created the second part of the series of this video, and if anybody called, then this is the destination. Is the Rook chef RGW object store, or in the this is a service name, and Rook chef is a namespace. We'll see that get svc Rook chef. So remember, this should be match, the service name should be matched with this one. So Rook chef RGW object store, and this is running on Rook chef, and we are using port 80. So 443, we can, because anyway this ingress is already we are configured HTTPS, so that's a fine. So we'll go and apply it. Kubectl apply minus f chef object storage virtual service. So we already applied, and we need to add the etc host file for s3 ramkitech.com. sudo vi/etc/host. So here I already added, so one is a chef ramkitech.com, last time I added, and this time I added s3.ramkitech.com. So both are added. Now open the browser. Last time the chef dashboard is able to access it. Now s3.ramkitech.com. So here this kind of XML I should get it, and it's telling that anonymous is ID, because we not at all pass any secret key and access keys. So point is, here I able to access the object storage. That's the important part. So now the setup of object storage is almost done. So there is one pod is created. The pod is responsible for requesting our object storage request. So it's like a HTTP REST based HTTP server. It's up and running. Now we need to always connect to that service, that URL. That URL is important. So that URL, I show that what the service name is running. That's a URL. So whenever we need the data, we need to call any HTTP client, any software, we can, any Java language, any programming language, you can use it to connect to that URL with our access key as well as a secret key. Then we need to tell what need to tell. Put HTTP method, put for store the data, get for retrieve the data, and head for retrieve only metadata. So, and delete for delete the file. So we already done that part. Now that object storage installation done. Okay, now object storage is done based on this part, but little bit we modified. For example, I added the certificate, I added and secure port I enabled. So you can refer my GitHub link, but part. Now, this is for external object storage. Suppose you don't have chef storage part of Kubernetes. If chef storage itself outside, we can able to access it. So now this part we don't want. We, for our scenario, it's not necessary. Now we'll come to the bucket. So here in object storage, there is a concept called bucket. And remember, bucket creation is expensive operation. You should not create unnecessary buckets. So bucket not equal to folder in the normal file system. The bucket is a little bit different. Bucket is like a container where we store all the files. In the object storage, files are stored in the flat structure. There's no files and folder concept in object storage. But based on the, while storing the file, we are giving the name. While giving the name, we'll give the name like the path1/path2. The slash is a delimiter. We able to mimic that files and folder structure like a normal typical file system. But actually, they're stored in the flat hierarchy. This object storage concept a bit different from the normal POSIX file systems. So now we are following this one. Okay, next we need to create the bucket. So whenever we need to create the bucket, we have some YAML file to create the buckets. So before create the bucket, we need to have one storage class. So it's exactly this entire concept is relevant to PVC. What PVC we are doing, we're creating on PVC. We are asking, I need 10 GB file, 10 GB volume I needed. Then the default or any storage class is provisioned the whatever you asked as a persistent volume. This is a RookChef that taken the same concept, and we need to create the below. We need to create the object bucket claim. It's like a PVC persistent volume claim. Here is object bucket claim. When you call this YAML file, that storage class provisioned the bucket for us. So it's a similar concept. So we go and create the storage class. And remember that YAML file, in the examples, everything we have. So we not at all build something new. So in the examples, when you go, there is a storage classes are available. So storage class, and the provisioner is RookChef, chef RookIO bucket. So it's based on, this is a provisioner creating our object store provisioning. Here you need to specify the your object store. So what are the object store while creating the first step? In object EC, what do you created? Is a my store. Then in this case, you need to give that same as a MyStore. So which object store is responsible for storing our data? That we need to give. And where that object store is stored, you usually created in the chef namespace only. So that's all. And here the important is reclaim policy is delete. So whenever you are deleting your object claim, next step you are going to create the object bucket claim. So whenever you claim deleted, underlying data should be deleted or not. That's command the reclaim policy is delete. There's a two YAML they given. One is for retaining. So retaining is even you deleted object claim, underneath bucket will be won't deleted. So that's a difference between that two. So we can go for delete. So that's okay, that's fine with us. And this is a storage class. So it's a follow the same storage gate IO. So in my code, I have the one storage class. Here, while the difference is in object EC, my name is object store, not a my store. Here I'm using object store. So based on that, we need to refer properly. So in the storage class bucket, I need to specify the object store. And I using the same rook chef only. And my reclaim policy is a delete. And the name of the storage class is rook chef bucket. This is what I given. So go and run it. So kubectl apply storage class bucket. So bucket is here, sorry, storage class is created. Kubectl get storage class SC is shortcut. You can see that now last video I created the two storage class, one for the block storage, one for the file system JFFS. But now we created the third storage class, name is ref charuk chef bucket. Okay, now storage class is created. Now we go for the object bucket claim. So whenever you want to create a bucket, we need to execute this YAML file. In this YAML file is a simple, we are mentioning that of some name of the this claim name, and there is a called generate bucket name. Suppose you want the bucket name exactly, there is a property called bucket name. They'll create the exact bucket name. Bucket name should be unique in the entire object store. That's a mandatory requirement. Suppose you can't create a unique, we go for this one. Generate the bucket name, we are giving some prefix. So underneath, they automatically add some random numbers in the suffix portion automatically. So it's always come as a unique variable. So unique bucket name. And the storage class, we need to specify the which storage class we need to provide our features. Because if you're not given the storage class, it will go for default storage class. But default storage class in this case is block storage. So block storage can't give the object bucket. So we need to give the proper storage class, which we third step we created. We need to mention the storage class name. So in our example, in what I have the given the YAML file, I'm giving the bucket claim. In the object bucket claim, I'm not using the generated bucket name. Instead of that, I'm using the bucket name. So bucket name, if you give data, exactly data is a bucket name is created. And remember, if you the second bucket name is the same data, it will fail. So you should be every time we need to have a unique bucket name. So I've called here as a data bucket. It's my object bucket claim name is this one. And there is additional configuration also available, but we're not used. In this case, we can specify how many objects or how many files can store inside. We can have like a quota or limiting that fact, and how much size we can store the data. So that kind of features are there. Now I removed, so I'm not giving any additional config. So we have unlimited data, we can store it. So apply that one, kubectl. Apply, minus f, object bucket claim. Object bucket claim. So it's look like a created. We verify kubectl get object bucket claim. So you can see here, and this is a very important thing is this is a namespace one. We are not giving namespace automatically. That's why they created in that default namespace. So it's up to us. When we create the project, which project you are creating on namespace, then you need to specify the namespace. The bucket will be created in the that namespace only. unfortunately, I'm not given the any namespace. So it by default the creating default namespace, and the name is data bucket. So meaning is bucket is created. So now bucket is created. There is a bunch of config managers are created in the config map is created in the default namespace. So we follow the same one. So get config map. This is the running the default namespace. There's a default namespace. There's a config map is created called chef delete bucket. Sorry, this is a old one. You can see that 46 hours old. So not that one, this one. For testing purpose, I did. So I'm not cleaned up properly. So data bucket, this is 72 seconds. So there is a five datas are there. We'll see that what are the things. So get the CM and data bucket. -io YAML file. So here that config map contains some information. First is bucket host. This is your URL. You know very well, we already seen this is a service name and this is a namespace. So this is your URL and this is a bucket name. And we see that the data is exactly the bucket name and bucket which port is running. As we know that there is a port, both ports are available. Port 80 also available, 443 also available. So we can use this either one. These three details are needed to connect to the server. That's a point one. And they have secret also. So we'll see that kubectl get. Okay, the secret, they have secret is two secrets available. Two data entries are available in the data bucket secret. So we go for edit mode. Edit secret data bucket. Okay, very important thing is here you can see that there is a access AWS access key ID and AWS secret key ID. Why are we using AWS? Because we are following S3 protocol. S3 protocol is belongs to AWS. So AWS only make it and popularized. So now the chef storage and every other object storage are follow their conventions. So this is the access ID and secret key. So access key and secret key, these both are important because whenever you want to put the file anything on that one, without this key, we are by default is forbidden or unauthorized. So because the HTTP server do authentication as well as authorizations. So when you give this both key information, then you are allowed to store or retrieve the files. So these are based in 64 encoded this data. So in the website, they given bunch of entries. That mean scripts are given. So same data, what we seen in the manually we did, we can able to get it in the single thing. So copy. Paste it. Now, okay. Ours are not a chef. Okay, here issue is we are given the config map is not a chef bucket because we changed as a data bucket. So what we'll do? Paste it locally and make sure that all our data bucket. And we are in the default namespace only, so that's no need to change anything. Okay, now all the information stored on these five variables. So we can use this one, we can echo it each one. So we'll come to know that what's going on. So we can see that echo each one. So there is a root chef is running, port is 443 and bucket name is data. This is my access key. The data what we stored in the secret is automatically the base64 decoded and stored data. And this is a secret key. So I got all the informations. Now we'll see what the rook chefing. Now that's all, we got all the information. Now we can go and connect it. we can download any S3 client, we can use it. Next video, I'll show you how to use a Spring and Java applications to connect and retrieve the data. This time we'll go the S5 CMD software. So this is a one Linux based tool. We can connect to any S3 compatible software, not only Chef. We can use the Amazon client tool also. So we go download section and download the Linux 64-bit, copy CD and wget. Okay, now tar minus x vf s5. So now there is a command is there, s5 cmd. Using this command, we are able to connect any S3 compatible object storage. In this case, our case is we are using Chef. So second step is we need to create the one file in the AWS, because we are following AWS. So the this command automatically check that in home folder, any AWS.AWS folder is there. Inside they have credential. We usually should store our access key and secret key. So just to copy this one as it is, and just come to root folder and execute this one. Okay, it's executed. Now check the file under the AWS credential. There's a full file is created. Here you can see that in the access key ID as well as a secret access key ID, both with the what are the information we retrieved from the secret is automatically stored here. So the next section is they're saying that you can create the one file and you are using that file using the S5 CMD, we can upload it. So, okay, now OBJ. We are creating one simple file, temporary file. File created, and this is the S5 CMD. We can able to access it. /, because we are not in the path location. So this is a command. Endpoint URL is, we change the URL because we don't want this URL. We can give our URL. s3.comkeytech.com. No need port number, and make sure that we are using HTTP. Yes. So this is the important thing, HTTPS, and this is our ramkeytech.com, and we are copying the file from local to here. This bucket name is, we are the environment variable already we captured before. Execute it, and there's one here where stop, cancel that one. Execute the S5 CMD. This command will show you, because ours are certificate are not trusted by this system. So for that, what we'll do, put no verify SSL. This is a command, we'll put it in the part of the thing. So okay. Put anywhere, but we'll put it consistently one location like this. Now you see that now data is copied. Okay, now how you verify? Again, S5 CMD have a lot of features. So when you run it, you can see that ls, rm, cp, it's almost like all Linux commands are available as a subcommand here. So we'll see that one by one. So instead of cp, remove the file name also, give ls. You can see here, they listed out, there is one file is available, it's 11 bytes file. And now same one, remove the S3 altogether, simply ls. You can see here, it show that S3 is a protocol and data is a bucket name. So there is one data bucket name is there, data, and this is information. And you want to do cat command, obviously available. So without download, you can watch from there only. s3:data is a bucket name and rook obj is a file name. You can see my data is able to, I can read it. So we'll see that what are the files are there. I want to copy all the data. So all the files, like a rook, entire rook is copied. Now see that they start to copy each and every file in the rook folder. So it's recursively take care and copy everything. So wait 2 minutes. Okay, I give some break, enough, that copy done. Now we see the ls command. So ls, so you can see that there is a rook folder and this is still in directory, and you have one file is outside. Suppose you want to know more recursively all the files in ls, you just give the slash and the star. This is S5CMD is a convention. When you hit like, you can see that you can read all the files in that one. And there is other commands also available. Instead of ls, you can use a du, the disk usage. We come to know that how much capacity used in the bucket. You can see that there is some numbers and 988 objects. So some human readable format. If you want, use -h. So in this case, you can see that the same data in the 57 megabytes data stored, total 988 objects are stored in that bucket. So you can use this S5CMD command. You can manipulate everything. And okay, this is what a part of thing I want to show that. And not only S5CMD, you can use any S3 compatible client. You can use it like a S3CMD available, but that for the Python need to be installed, or you can use some GUI tools also available. So that's all this one. Next video, what we are going to do, we are putting in Java application to connect it both externally or internally in the pod only, how to connect this all are we are going to see in the next video. And after that, I'm going to cover some detailed object storage based one, and I go some comparison study with the MinIO. So another popular object storage is provided by the community. So let's see. We'll see next time. Bye.